You're watching Infosec Bytes, a crash course in information security for journalists. We're based at the Center for Investigative Journalism in London and supported by the Logan Foundation. This video is part 3 of our introduction to PGP. This video is provided for information only. It cannot replace the advice of a trained security professional. If lives or safety depend on your security, please seek the advice of an expert. The Center for Investigative Journalism is a pioneer in providing expert information security training services to journalists and journalistic institutions. To consult with an expert through the CIJ or to arrange a CIJ training session, contact the address on screen. The tutorial you're about to watch is part of our series on PGP. If you haven't seen the others, click or tap on the pop-up message to access the playlist. In previous videos, we've explained that PGP is public key encryption for email. And we explained how public key encryption was an important advance on a previous form of encryption called symmetric encryption. But we've not yet explained how we got from the invention of public key encryption to PGP. You see, public key cryptography was first invented in the late 1970s by a group of computer scientists and mathematicians based at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. They were Ron Rivest, Adi Shamir, and Leonard Edelman. Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman not only conceived the idea of public key cryptography, but they developed the first working example of public key encryption. They called it RSA, after their own initials. Because of how valuable public key encryption was, it was a business opportunity. RSA was patented, and Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman formed the company RSA Security, which began to sell products based on RSA. Throughout the 1980s, access to public key cryptography was expensive, and it was not widely available to the general public. But an American computer scientist called Phil Zimmerman became interested in making public key encryption available for the masses. In the 1980s, Zimmerman was an anti-nuclear activist and saw the importance of encryption as a tool for ordinary people to protect their privacy against government intrusion and safeguarding their rights. Towards the end of the 1980s and over the first years of the 1990s, Zimmerman designed and wrote a program which did public key encryption for email and which could run on affordable computers at the time. Zimmerman used the RSA algorithm to do the encryption in his program. He called the program Pretty Good Privacy, PGP. Zimmerman originally planned on releasing PGP as shareware. As shareware, users would download a free trial version of PGP, and if they wanted to use all of the features, they would pay for a full version of the software. But Zimmerman was involved in a dispute with RSA Security, which claimed that PGP violated its patent on the RSA algorithm. Nevertheless, Zimmerman was still interested in selling PGP. But in 1991, something happened that changed his mind. A clause was introduced to the US Senate's 1991 anti-crime bill, seeking to force encryption providers to break their products. It said that all makers of such products must be able to provide the government with unencrypted messages on request. The US government was trying to make unauthorized encryption illegal. In retaliation, before the law could be passed, Zimmerman published his PGP program under a free software license. This meant he could no longer hope to make any profit off the sale of the software, but anyone could use it for free. Instead, he wanted to make sure that public key encryption spread as freely and widely as possible before the US government could criminalize it. PGP became a sensation on the early internet. It was distributed on message boards, downloaded and copied, and shared on floppy disks between friends and privacy-minded computer users. It spread all over the world very quickly. Before long, it was the main program that ordinary people, if they wanted to, could use to do public key encryption. It helped kickstart an early movement for online privacy, the cypherpunks, digital activists and cryptography fans who advocated the importance of encryption to protect against government snooping. Design flaws and bugs in the original code of PGP were also removed, as other enthusiasts, computer programmers and cryptographers collaborated to rewrite the code of PGP, resulting in improved new versions of the software. As a result of what he did, Zimmerman fell into legal trouble. Shortly after PGP was let loose on the internet, he began receiving visits from the FBI. The FBI was interested in how it was that the PGP software had been downloaded by users in Europe. You see, cryptography was officially classified as a munition by the US government, and there were heavy restrictions on the export of munitions outside the United States. The FBI chose to look on the distribution of PGP to other countries over the internet as an export of a munition. For several years, Zimmerman was the subject of a federal grand jury investigation in the United States, which sought to charge him with violating US export controls. The effort to prosecute Zimmerman was part of a larger effort on the part of the US government to restrict and prevent the use of encryption by the general public, attempting to insert so-called backdoors into encryption products so that the government could break the encryption if it needed to. These efforts, and the fight back against them by cypherpunks and groups like the Electronic Frontier Foundation, became known as the Crypto Wars. Meanwhile, during the course of the 1990s, strong cryptography found its way into lots of consumer software and became a mainstay of modern computing. Nowadays, whenever you log into your bank account, your browser is using encryption to ensure that your connection is secure. Eventually, the grand jury investigation into Phil Zimmerman was discontinued, and Zimmerman was not prosecuted. PGP was already everywhere, and access to strong encryption was guaranteed for the public. The government had decided to back off. In the years since Phil Zimmerman published PGP, it has come a long way. Instead of just being a piece of software, PGP became a protocol, or an open standard, for doing public key encryption for email. This meant that lots of different programs can be written, and as long as they follow the open PGP standard, they will be compatible with each other. Nowadays, the most common and widespread piece of software that does PGP is called GPG. GPG is short for GNU Privacy Guard. It's a full free software version of PGP, which can be installed on Windows, Mac, and on GNU Linux operating systems. If you're going to encrypt your emails with PGP, it's most likely that the software you use will be GPG. So, if you want PGP and see GPG and get confused, don't worry. GPG is the name of the software. You're still doing PGP. PGP enables you to do encrypted email, and it's still pretty good for that. But one of the problems with PGP is that it is still a really complicated piece of software. Part of this is the fact that it is nearly 30 years old now. Back in 1991, when it was first released, PGP could only be used on a command line interface by learning off special commands to make it do things and typing them into a text interface, like this. But back in 1991, this was a normal way of using computers. Computers were still something you had to acquire skills to use, and they were not quite as universal as they are now. PGP was very much designed for the computer user of its time. Nowadays, computers are everywhere, and they are much easier to use than they were. Most programs have a graphical user interface, an easy-to-use, accessible way of using the software. PGP is no exception. PGP has graphical user interfaces, and this does make it a little easier for the general user. But it is also still a program of its time. It still has tons of options, strange terminology, and is quite complicated, and these things can't be swept away with nice graphics. It also expects you to do a lot of things manually, such as managing your keys. More modern encryption programs like Signal Private Messenger automate these things. They all happen without you having to worry about them. But more modern encryption programs tend to avoid using email altogether. By computer standards, email is a very ancient way of communicating, and it is much easier to write secure encryption software for more modern communications, such as smartphone messaging. As a result, nobody has yet written an encryption program for email that replaces PGP. There are plenty of efforts to do this, but these applications are not yet widely used. Email isn't going anywhere, and so if you use email and you need encryption, the only game in town is PGP. So using PGP isn't as simple as just downloading an app, like Signal, and starting to use it right away. You first of all have to understand a little bit about what public key encryption is and how it works, which is why we've spent some time explaining these concepts in previous videos. You also have to master the software in order to use PGP properly and safely. And starting to use the software to do PGP can also be a bit intimidating. Most introductions to PGP for the newcomer focus on getting people to use PGP on Mac or Windows, because those are the operating systems that people are used to. For example, on Windows, you can install GPG along with the Mozilla email program Thunderbird, and a special plugin for Thunderbird called Enigmail. Using these programs together, you can generate your PGP keys, download other people's PGP keys, and send and receive encrypted email. You can do the same with Mac OS, or you can choose to install GPG Tools, which incorporates GPG into your Apple Mail program. Both of these suites of software try their best to make PGP, a nearly 30-year-old piece of software, usable and understandable for computer users today. Unfortunately, that's really difficult to do. The sheer number of options available in PGP and the sheer amount of things PGP expects you to do manually result in these applications becoming extremely complicated and having endless menus and complexity that just can't be eliminated. Plenty of people swear by these programs, but in our experience, they are difficult for beginners to understand, and those difficulties often result in beginners making mistakes and misusing the software, resulting in their emails being sent without encryption, something which could be dangerous. On top of this, Windows and Mac OS are not designed to maximize privacy for the general user, and if users are interested in communicating privately, they are best advised not to use these operating systems. In our forthcoming tutorials, to avoid all of these problems, we have chosen to demonstrate how to use PGP on the Tails operating system only. Tails, as we explain in our video Introduction to Tails, is a specialist operating system which is designed for maximum security and privacy. Running on your laptop or desktop computer, it is a secure alternative to Windows or Mac OS. Among its many features, Tails adds a custom suite of encryption software with the safest, most secure presets. All of the software you need to do PGP encryption comes already installed on Tails. You don't have to install anything in order to get going. Furthermore, Tails makes the process of using PGP much, much simpler. It's easier to get started, and it's also much easier to see when you're doing it wrong. If you need to use PGP to communicate securely, we recommend that you only do so using Tails. If you get a hold of Tails, you'll find it much easier to learn to use PGP, and it will also be much safer to boot. For a full introduction to Tails before you watch the rest of our PGP tutorials, click or tap on the pop-up message and choose Introduction to Tails. In the next video in our PGP series, we will begin to get hands-on with PGP on a Tails system and show you how to generate your own public and secret keys, how to share your public key with others, and how to get everyone else's public keys so that you can communicate securely. To watch that video, click or tap on the pop-up message and choose Managing Your PGP Keys. Thanks for watching Infosec Bytes. If you found this video useful, please share it widely with your colleagues and co-workers. To support the Center for Investigative Journalism with a donation, please visit tcij.org/donate. And if you would like to watch our other videos, please go to infosecbytes.org or subscribe to our channel below.